Jump in, but I'll let Kate get started on the articles.
So we have an article. Just gonna go article by article. If you have any questions or anything that you didn't understand, please let us know. We're gonna start with Article 3, General Provisions, 3.05. We are going to continue our stance on that, and we're gonna say no to that change. Under 3.07, the availability of BCC policies, some clarification. So currently, all of our BCC policies, keep in mind, when this says BCC policies, we have department policies as listed, but the BCC, who the CBA is with, is still going to be EMS. Those are departmental policies, and they're usually noted as BCC policy. Those are in Target Solutions. When you bring up on the main page, you can click in the bottom right of the link, and it takes you to every policy we currently have in-house. Power DMS is where employees go to sign to agree that they've acknowledged the policy. Well, that document is there, which is able to be seen, especially if there is a county policy that comes out. Were we off or what?
No.
So those are currently there. So Target Solutions currently has all of our policies under there. And then that's what the Power DMS is for as well. So that is basically already being done. It's already there and it's already available. Email communications, yeah. So that's pretty much our stance on that. It's already there and it's already being done. There's really no changes to make to that. Other than as we move forward and change the policies themselves. 4.01, we're saying no to the added proposed language under the use of facilities. We want to keep the language as is. And the addition of 4.10, which would pretty much negate all those other ones unless it comes back, we're just saying no to all that. It's going to automatically remove. Because of the law changes, 4.04 through 4.07, which then we're going to remove, we're not agreeable to the 4.10 either. So that will remove all of those. 4.09, we had already agreed to that. So that one was already TA'd. 4.08. I was hoping Kristen would jump back on, but for language purposes, we just simply wanted to just change some of the language. The way you have it listed, it says to ensure that the union is allowed time. The training supervisor shall notify the union department specific orientation on the first day of such orientation. Their first day of orientation is provided by human resources, and that comes out in an email from human resources, not our training department. And that therein is the best place because it's basically a big one day, all day meeting with everybody in there going over HR stuff, where typically the union would have the ability to go in and have those discussions with the new employees. So we're just want to change the language to notate. And what is that email? It's called the onboarding email. It usually comes from Ivy here from us. And they can coordinate with Ivy through that email. They can be added to the list to be notified. It's very simple. It goes out to everybody to let them know what day everyone is starting. And we're going to add that language. We need to get clarification exactly how it will be worded for you.
Hey, Chief.
Yeah.
Traditionally, we have met with the employees at Post 10 during in-house orientation, during the portion where they're in there with Tasha or whoever else.
We do our own HR stuff in-house now, and it's done here at Post 10. Ivy does all of our onboarding process and that new day of orientation here in room 232 at Public Safety Headquarters, and that is a perfect opportunity. You'll have time to sit down and discuss with them, because, you know, the time that you need. They usually bring us in to meet and greet them, and We don't want to take away from their time where they're doing training, where they're in the training room doing that stuff. Those two need to be separate. One is the clinical side of it. The other is the onboarding with the county side of it, which is where that needs to be done. And traditionally, based on my experience, that's where it's done in my previous employment as well. That's what we're proposing, that it's done in that meeting.
Okay.
But you, we can simply add whatever email you all suggest.
Okay.
To give you notification.
Correct. All right, thank you.
So 5.03, number four, letter B. You had proposed changing it to 5 business days there in the last portion of that very last sentence. We're okay with that. I think we can see that. I think that was the only change. I didn't see any.
Yeah, the 10 days here.
Okay.
Oh, it's a misprint. Proposal, we have the same thing listed twice. I think it's just a better definition, 5.01. The third little grouping there, days shall mean, that's printed on there twice. We just need to remove. That was it for 5, yeah. Article 6, seniority number 2, we do not want to entertain that because there's numerous other reasons why people would have to be moved where we can't do things by seniority or don't have the opportunity to do so. Article 7, no to letter D. That is a process that is supposed to be made as confidential as possible with all parties involved, be it HR or whomever. So just we're going to say no to letter D. Point 02, Article 8, number 2. We're saying no to the proposed language, and just we want to leave the language as it is currently written in there. There is an extension already written in there, but we don't want to change that process with the addition of the language that you proposed.
Yes, clerk of the court.
Yeah, that's actually going to fall under the clerk of the court, and there's a whole separate section of process that follows that. 8.02, number 4. All right, we had a discussion about this previously in one of our last meetings to understand how this worked. It says employees must, your proposed language is employees must be notified 72 hours before scheduled leave, whether the leave is denied or approved. So we do not deny leave. Leave is only approved. And the reason being is when you put in your request in Telestaff, an asterisk is put beside your name. If your leave is approved, the asterisk disappears. If your leave is not approved, then it stays. Most importantly, and this has happened several times that I can think of, where we have had, say, 2 people off and another person put in, which basically put them in a waiting position because we weren't allowed to prove anyone else off. One of the original 2 people decided to cancel their vacation. Well, it's not incumbent upon the supervisor to try to remember who the person that was whose leave they denied that disappeared out of the computer, because if you deny it, the request goes away. That is why those stay in there, so that if, as long as the person who requested it that didn't initially get it, put it in the 7 days prior within compliance, and another person cancels before that person can figure it out, we will absolutely call them and go, hey, someone else canceled. You put your time in within a reasonable request of 7 days. You can still have it if you want it. And that's the reason why they don't get denied. They only get approved. Now, the language we would like to add, and Kristen, can you help me with this? You worded this beautifully. Sorry, she's on mute. Oh, no, that's her.
That's her.
Kristen, that's going to be Article 8. 0.02, number 4.
Approvals will be documented in Telestaff not less than 7 days before the requested leave date.
So meaning on our end that 7 days, no less than 7 days prior to the date, because then it matches your requirement to put your leave in. You will know 7 days out, because we understand that, you know, maybe you want to go out of town, you've got to reserve rooms, you've got to pay for things. You have to know that those things are secured and you're not going to lose money, or that you're able to do so. And the reason it's 7 and 7, because one matches the other. And as long as the employee put in within 7 days, even if they don't initially get it, if someone cancels last minute and it's only, say, you know, 2 days away or something happened and that person's still eligible, then they can have the leave, no problem, no questions asked, because they followed the policy. So that is our proposed language for number four.
Okay. And we're good with that. I don't think it was necessarily a notice of denial that we were looking for. I think it's just, it has happened in the past to where even if somebody was put in past the 7 days, it wasn't getting the asterisk removed, be approved, even though they were approved because they were within 7 days or past 7 days and there was no other people off. And I think that's what some people were concerned with, because they're still looking at it like the asterisk never went away. Okay. But what you're saying is that it is approved because you put it in more than 7 days and there wasn't two people off. So as long as that's good, we're good.
Yeah, and the good fail safe to that, Chad, is that let's say a supervisor makes a mistake. All we have to do is hover over your name and go, oh, look, no, they put it in with 7 days. And, you know, obviously you can hover over each person's name. It tells you the date and time they submitted. We'll know who was first, who was second, and so on. But we can make the correction on behalf of the supervisor if they made an error. Perfect. And still let the employee know, you know, apologies for not getting this done earlier. It was a mistake, but yeah. Okay, so that's fair.
All right.
8.03, sick leave. The first sentence where you had added 12, we're going to stick with county policy there. But the second sentence where you have the word scheduled, we're okay with that. Scheduled sick leave shall be made not less than 24 hours. We're okay with that second piece that's bold and underlined there. Everything else in the English sense, right? Yeah. Yes. So everything else in that section, we are not in agreement to under section 8, but we wanted to discuss 8.08. So I would agree, and you know, if it's something related to court matters, the employee's going to be paid, of course. But the second piece there where it says employee scheduled to work the night before the court summons shall be granted administrative court leave. For the second half of the shift, and then employees are required to work the night before the court summons, will be granted administrative court leave for the first half. We would like to make a compromise and give you the option of either they can have the entire shift off the night before or the entire shift off the day after for serving their court summons. And the reason being is it makes it very difficult operationally to try to fill half shifts, especially if you hear someone off half a shift in the middle of the night. Getting somebody to come in to cover that's going to be problematic. We would rather cover a whole shift and know that the employee's covered and the shift is covered. I don't know if you're prepared to make any decision on that, if you guys are talking amongst yourselves or whatever, or if that's something you would like to get back, but that's our proposed language change. That's all work related to not for coming. Article 9, we're good with. That's okay. We'd like to TA that. Article 10, hours of work and overtime, going down to, and is it 10.04? Is that still the right number? Okay. 10.04. We're going to stick with FLSA on that and not make any of the additional changes for the 12 hours. We are going to say no to 10.05. 10.06. Yeah, and pretty much all the rest of the other sections under section 10, those are all operational type things that have the ability to need to ebb and flow, and we cannot put concrete in writing. Article 12, we did have this discussion last time. One of the things, I see that you have made changes to your wage request. One of the things we had asked last time for is comparables that you're comparing yourself with for these requests, and your projections of what you think the total cost of this is going to be for the pay increases that you're asking for. I know that when we had our last meeting, I had asked those questions, and that had not yet been done. So we would like to see those back. That was all 4.01. Um, Yeah, okay. So the same for 12.04 under the field training differential that's in there. We'd also like to ask you to provide some comparables as well with the field training officer request there. Not sure if it's confusion or just a guesstimation, but under 12.06 under the degree stipends, I know this because I came from fire. Chad, you probably know this too. Those are the exact rate of what is paid, but that is state reimbursement for fire. They're actually the county reimbursed for that, for those rates. And they're the only ones reimbursed for that. We are not. So we're going to say no to that because that is an actual state reimbursement that covers the 25, 15, 75 for each level of the degrees.
Can you skip five?
Sorry, you're right. 1.05. That is something we'd like to work toward, but we're not prepared to even make that assessment yet. That is going to take some time to build upon. That is a wish list thing, as everybody knows, but we're not ready to discuss that one yet. So we're going to just say no to that at this time, as well as 12.06. Again, another wish list. I think it's a great idea, but not something that we can look at right now. So we're going to say no to that as well. Article 15, miscellaneous benefits, 15.02 under holiday. We're going to stick with county policy. And we, for the remainder of, Article 15, because we just got this, of course, we're going to need to look at some, we're going to need to have some more discussion on our part as to language and things like that we would like to propose regarding the rest of Article 15. It's just going to take us some time to put that together, unfortunately. 15.02 was sectioned off based on your request for a new article, and we want to keep things the way they are. So we're not even at this point considering Articles 21, 22, or 23. Again, as those are operational things that we cannot put in a CBA, that there's just too many dynamics to it in order for us to make it. And I think that is everything that we've been able to look at so far. Yes. Yeah, please. You have just on a copy, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think it does. It's almost now. Granted, it's got a few more things added. Yeah. So the MOU that you sent us, which kind of falls under what's that? Is that 10.06 under Article 10, hours of work and overtime. A lot of the thinking here are operational, as well as. At this point, we've covered some of these things before, and this is not something that we're looking to do to have an MOU at this point, because it would restrict our ability should something like this happen. General discussion with the Union E-Board on this would be, I think, more prudent than coming up with an MOU, especially for something as important as this, because that's pretty much all operational decision. So I think that's it. That's all we have just in our discussion. Any questions or anything else as far as that particular piece goes?
Yes, he will be reducing those to writing, or you have reduced them to writing by chance.
Yeah, so that's correct. We've got everything but 15, okay. Because we're still looking, as I said, we're still having some discussion and trying to figure out some language and things like that.
Understood.
So we can get 15 to them before we meet next. That way they can have a discussion.
Yeah, have a meeting. Yeah, we can get to 15 once we get all of our proposed changes and whatnot to that as well.
Okay. So do we want to discuss dates down the road? I mean, we don't want to.
You can just email me and okay. we'll work through that.
Okay. I think that sounds good. We do not have anything else for today.
Hey, Mr. Matt, you got, y'all said you had an issue too y'all wanted to bring up?
No, not at this time. I did send you, Chief, a cease and desist letter over the shift changes. But I don't think that we're going to discuss them during negotiations.
Yeah, I think that'd be prudent. Yeah, that I don't want to discuss operational. If anything operational, let's keep those separate if we can.
Yeah, I mean, they do touch, as you see, there is a demand to bargain, but I don't think that's going to be for today because it does touch mandatory subjects of bargaining. So I do think that we will need to set up a separate time for it.
Yeah, we can do it.
Okay.
Just question, just so I know, I'm just asking for language clarification because you wrote this and you're online. So just a quick question. What does shift changes mean?
I'm going to actually, Chad, do you want to jump in and explain the shift changes? We're talking about the changes on B shift that were recently made, where the entire groups were swapped around. I tried to use the best language I could. Chad, do you want to?
Yeah, so just the shift changes is in reference to the in-house move of everybody that happened on B shift. So changed partners, changed unit assignments, changed post working locations. That's what that's referring to.
Okay. Offline, but yeah,
thanks for
the clarification. I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. We will, once we get our language down, I'll send that over to you and we can discuss it.
Yeah, no worries. We appreciate it.
All right, we're going to stop the recording and get offline. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.